Good evening and welcome to the County Connection. I'm your host this evening, County Commissioner Kevin Barnhardt. We let Gene take a break this evening because we have a lot to cover in the 26 minutes we have this evening. I have with us tonight part of the group of readingbridges.net. There is a much larger group, a subgroup of about two dozen people, and we can only fit so many people in the studio tonight. But we want to focus on the closure of the Buttonwood Street Bridge, which will actually start July 20th. Of this year and go to approximately April of 2017. And I have with us this evening Gail Landis, the Vice President of Government Affairs for the Chamber of Commerce, correct, who is on the readingbridges.net committee. She's actually co-chair, and Alan Piper, the county's transportation planner. We're going to cover a lot of aspects tonight as quickly as possible. We're going to talk about the purpose of the bridge closure. Going to talk about the origin of readingbridges.net, which has been around the local area for about 2 years. We're going to discuss the impact on commuters and pedestrians, and then finish up with alternatives. So we figure if we're going to impact folks by the closure of the bridge, we want to also provide them alternatives. So we will start out with the purpose of the bridge being closed. It was built 83 years ago, actually by the county commissioners 83 years ago, to provide transportation for walkers and, at that time, vehicles to go back and forth to commute from Reading to West Reading and Wyomissing for work-related activities. It went through a major overhaul in 1972, and as many things eventually wear out, it's beyond its useful life. It's 83 years old, and it needs a major overhaul. It's been weight-restricted for many years, and we really want to see a new enhanced bridge with decorative lighting and everything, which is going to happen. It carries about 16,500 vehicles a day, so it's a major impact on the artery going to and from the city of Reading and to Western Berks County. So Gail will explain to us the actual origins of readingbridges.net and who's all involved in it. So Gail, take it away.
Thank you, Kevin. Yes, about 2 years ago, we were sitting around talking and saying, how are we going to keep our community vibrant when we start all this bridge construction in the area? And thanks to you to becoming one of my co-chairs, we pulled a work group together, which is a very diverse group, but people that are key stakeholders in our community. So how are we going to keep our economy vibrant, and how are we going to keep our quality of place in good working order during this two-year construction of Buttonwood Bridge? It includes the county commissioners, the Greater Reading Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Commuter Services of Pennsylvania, BARTA. We also have our Convention and Visitors Bureau involved with us, and PennDOT, of course, we keep them up to date of what we're doing, and just various entertainment groups that are key, the West Reading, the City of Reading, Everybody just pulled together into what we call a public-private partnership, which is really unheard of across the state, of a group that has come together utilizing our own resources and leveraging them to make sure our community is informed of what's going to be happening.
Yeah, it's amazing how it grew. Gail and I spoke at a chamber breakfast and said, holy cow, somebody has to inform somebody. And we don't want to be the people standing in the room saying, somebody should have told us the bridge was closing. And that was about 2 years ago. And from you and I, it grew to, like I said, almost two dozen active people. And the more we talked about it, you have to put the entertainment venues involved, the utilities involved, the communities involved, the schools involved, Reading Area Community College, Reading School District, up and down the line. And so many people have graciously put a link to readingbridges.net on their websites. And that's a way for us to get that information out there. Folks can access it on their smartphones. We understand that there wasn't a major impact on the Schuylkill Avenue Bridge being closed one lane in either direction. And Alan informs us on our way in that they believe that's going to be completely reopened to traffic by the end of this week, hopefully the early part of next week, because we want to emphasize the Buttonwood Street Bridge will be closed completely July 20th moving forward. So that will relieve some of the traffic. And then ultimately, when Buttonwood Street is finished in potentially April of 2017, then PennDOT will be moving to the Penn Street Bridge, and then potentially, and it's not on their schedule, probably a major overhaul of the Bingham Street or Lancaster Avenue Bridge. They did shore that up a little bit this fall. There were some structural deficiencies, but we're looking at this multi-year, multi-phase ReadingBridges.net, which impacts not just Buttonwood, it'll impact Penn and ultimately the Bingham Street Bridge. So it's a good effort, and we applaud everyone. No one's taking a salary. Everyone's working as a volunteer, using each other's copying machine and using each other's ability to use their websites. And we really want to especially thank BCTV for their coverage. I think this is probably our fourth or fifth show emphasizing the closure. We actually did an on-site program for around Berks County at the bridge. I want to thank Channel 69 News, especially the Reading Eagle, who has done a tremendous amount of graphics for us and actually hosts our website. And then we have the merchants in West Reading, the Downtown Improvement District, and the Chamber of Commerce, who allows you to help in your spare time when you're not worrying about the state budget and how it impacts local businesses.
That's very true, very, very true. And I think just having the work group come together, because they did it for the right reason. Mm-hmm. They want our community to be vibrant. We want our economy to be vibrant. And just keeping the information relevant and timely, and keeping that ReadingBridges.net, which is an interactive website, mm-hmm. where they can go and learn a lot more about what the schedules are, what the detours are, and then also what we're going to talk about a little bit later about some other resources that are available for both commuters and residents in the area.
And I think that's one of the lessons learned by especially myself and some folks on the committee, how flexible and engaging and helpful BARTA is with what they're going to be providing for the folks, as well as commuter services. Commuter services covers the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Matt Boyer is its executive director. He handles this 7-county region. Mm-hmm. And it's really impactful for finding people safer ways and more less congested ways to get in and out of major arteries. So it's a good thing. We've learned a lot from each other, and maybe we'll have to have an alumni breakfast once it's over. Maybe we'll have a pig roast at the bridge in April of 2017 and celebrate the opening of the bridge. Be a good thing. So, Alan, let's talk about the impact of the bridge and what people should expect. Maybe you want to give us a little bit of the why the bridge is being closed in its entirety, as well as what people can expect the detours to be posted and what the detours will look like.
Okay, well, I think the biggest impact is, why is the bridge being closed completely? Other bridges have been able to do it in half width. You keep half of it open and move the lanes around. And why can't we do that here? The biggest problem is the way the bridge is actually constructed. It's not designed in a way that you can take it apart half at a time. Several of the beams, particularly the ones that are over the river, need to be replaced. You can't have a beam going halfway across or it falls down, mm-hmm. falls down into the river. The other thing is that the entire surface of the bridge, the part that you travel on, is beyond repair. That all needs to be taken off. Plus the sidewalks, plus the deterioration to the parapets on the side. In addition to that, there are 4 different utilities that run through the sidewalks of the bridge. They all need to be, one, temporarily relocated and then permanently reinstalled in the new bridge that'll result from this project. So what that really means then is that the bridge cannot remain open to traffic during construction, and also it cannot remain open for pedestrians during the construction, just because of the fact that there's so much work that's going to go on underneath the sidewalks and immediately adjacent to that. In the end, all the beams will be repaired, the concrete will be repaired, the parapets will be repaired in kind to look exactly, or at least almost exactly, like they do now. There'll be new decorative lighting, period lighting that's placed on the bridge, and there'll be additional safety factors for pedestrians in that there'll be a barrier placed between the roadway and the sidewalks.
Very aggressive schedule as well. I mean, the contractor is planning on working pretty significant hours, if you can tell us that, Alan.
Yeah, PennDOT bid this project opened the bids for this project at the end of May. The successful contractor is J.D. Ekman. They were given their notice to proceed a week ago, Thursday. And they'll be moving in. They're right now, they're hastily preparing. I know that there were meetings going on with the utility companies
today
already. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Signs will be going up at the bridge informing traffic that the bridge is going to be closed by next Monday, July the 6th. In the week of July the 13th, they will begin installing improvements that are related to the detour routes. And then actually on July 20th itself will be the day that we've all been preparing for. That's the first day that the bridge is going to be closed.
Now, before we move to the detours, I want you to explain, at some of our community meetings, we had many community meetings in Reading and West Reading, and try to have as much interaction here on BCTV. But one of the concerns was the traffic on the West Shore Bypass. Mm-hmm. And that's to be done off hours in the evening, and there'll be restricted lanes, but that will be patrolled and monitored, I believe, by the state police to make sure there's no issue with commuters probably starting at 10 or 11 o'clock.
Right. There are a few beams on the section that goes over the West Shore Bypass that'll need to be repaired, and that'll all be done. That work will all mm-hmm. be done at night.
Very good. If we can zoom into the Buttonwood Street Bridge detours, I think we have a graphic to put up so you don't have to, there we go. No, that's the, there we go, that's a perfect one. If Alan can explain, if the viewers at home can see that map, at least we can see it here in the studio, Alan can go into some of the finer points of the detours and what to expect come July 20th.
Okay, if we, the bridge itself is located in the upper left side, it's the yellow line that crosses the river. Detour coming from the Reading side, starting roughly in the center top, comes down Schuylkill Avenue to an intersection at Front Street, goes up Walnut Street to 2nd Street, south on 2nd Street to Penn Street, crosses the Penn Street Bridge, crosses through the bypass interchange, and then goes up Penn Avenue in West Reading until it gets back to Talpahockin Street or 5th Avenue in West Reading. Coming from West Reading side back to the city, it's almost the opposite of that route. You follow Penn Avenue back down across the interchange with the bypass, across the river on the Penn Street Bridge to 2nd Street, where you'll go south on 2nd Street to Franklin Street, loop around Reading Area Community College, and then go back north on Front Street until you get back to Buttonwood Street, and that ends the detour. Now, as a part of that, there's a number of improvements that are going to be made that to help the traffic. First of all is at the intersection of Schuylkill Avenue and Front Street, a new traffic signal will be installed. It's a temporary traffic signal. Right now, there's just one stop sign there for northbound Front Street traffic. So that's being added for a safety factor. The more involved improvements will be in West Reading. One of the first things that we realized is that with the volume of traffic that's using the bypass or that's using the bridge, is that there really are no other alternatives. So most of that traffic has to shift to Penn Street, and you're going to create almost 50% increase in traffic on Penn Street and Penn Avenue. And we didn't want that traffic to back out onto the bypass and create a safety factor out there. So the way to get around that is to add more lanes to Penn Avenue from 2nd Avenue in West Reading all the way up to 5th Avenue.
And you're heading westbound.
Westbound, that's correct. What's currently a left turn is available as a left turn lane. Or a center turning lane will be converted exclusively into a westbound through lane all the way to 5th, where it will turn into a left turn lane onto 5th, because a lot of the traffic that would have come across Buttonwood Street goes through the traffic circle in Reading and then down 5th. One thing that goes along with that is the fact that left turns from Penn Avenue in West Reading between 2nd and 4th, well, between 2nd and 5th, will be prohibited. You can't make a left at 3rd, and you can't make a left at 4th. You'll have to, if you want to get south of Penn Avenue in West Reading, you'll have to turn northbound at 3rd Avenue, go down Redding Avenue, and back across 4th Avenue, or go all the way up and make your left at 5th, and then circle back to where you were going.
So from your earlier comments, it sounds like you're going to start to see these warning signs in about a week. It's going to say,
right,
Buttonwood Street Bridge will be closed July 20th, Monday, July 20th, and you'll start to see these signs going off throughout the community. There's going to be a traffic light at Front and Walnut in the city of Reading,
right,
as well, which will surprise people to see that. So people have to get accustomed to this. So what we've encouraged folks to do is start looking for alternative routes, not today, not wait till July 20th and figure out I can't go across the Buttonwood Street Bridge, because 16,500 cars doesn't sound like a lot, but stand there and watch them on a normal day. That's a lot of cars.
It is.
And they're going to find alternative routes. Either it's the West Shore Bypass, or it's the Penn Street Bridge, or the Bingham Street Bridge, or the Schuylkill Avenue Bridge. It's going to cause some congestion, but ultimately we want this to be a real positive. To be a rehabilitated bridge with very nice lights, no weight restrictions, and we're going to really see that as a mirror image of what the Penn Street Bridge may look like in years to come as well.
That's
so all of these projects are well overdue. A lot of it had to do with many years of funding through the federal and state government. I think they're on the transportation improvement plan for almost 12 years. We talk about this bridge as being a county-owned bridge, but it's a PennDOT-funded, primarily most of it's federal and state money, and it takes such a long period of time to put all this money together. I think it's close to $14 million.
Yep.
It takes that amount of time and energy, and then to meet all the permitting and regulations and meeting with the utilities and getting all the right-of-way improvements, it takes some time. So we met with a lot of community groups, and we have the information out there, and we're just happy to be able to let people know that here's this way we're going. So if you can bring up this one actually is the Buttonwood Street Bridge closure details. This deals with commuter services, which Alan can highlight. And then we can swing over to the alternative routes of BARTA. So if actually you serve on the committee of commuter services, Alan. So
yeah,
you're an expert in the field.
Commuter services is designed to find a way to help reduce the volume of traffic on highways, really to get people out of their single occupancy vehicles and reducing the total number of trips that are taken. It's completely federally funded. It's free for anybody to call, to use, any businesses to consult with. They do an awful lot of work all over eastern Pennsylvania. You said the whole state. It is just eastern Pennsylvania.
I think that is the state, just eastern Pennsylvania. Don't tell my friends in Pittsburgh.
But basically, they work with companies and try and set up carpooling programs, ride sharing. In some cases, if there's a high enough demand, they'll do van pooling. They work very extensively with the local transit agencies trying to encourage people to use transit where they can.
And alternate scheduling, work from home,
right,
telecommuting, right.
And they're also very high on promoting biking to work, mm-hmm, and even walking if you have that opportunity. It's not only is it good for the congestion, it's good for your health.
And that information was up on the screen. Commuter Services is 1-866-579-RIDE, R-I-D-E, or that's 7433. There it's there again. It's very important. We've had people ask us about alternate schedules or alternate start and end times for some of the major employers. We do kind of have that built in at the Courthouse and Services Center. City Hall has some alternate schedules. Reading Air Community College, by virtue of the students coming and going to many classes, there is some built-in schedule flexibility in downtown Reading. We even, to the extent, went to the entertainment community, because there could be the opportunity for a concert and a hockey game going on simultaneously, and we encourage them to maybe stagger those start and end times for those amusements, because we want this to remain vibrant. We want Reading to remain vibrant. We want Wine Missing and West Reading to remain just as it is, beautiful places to workshop. So one of the other things we want to touch on before we run out of time is BARTA's opportunity that they have created a park and ride behind R.J. Willoughby's, and up there is one of the flyers. They were finally able to get the lot behind R.J. Willoughby's off of Park Road to provide a park and ride, a shuttle service, to come to downtown Reading. Alan, you want to go through some of the particulars of that?
Sure. The lot, caught me off guard on that one.
There you go.
When is it going to start? It's going to start July 13th. So when they start working on the detour route, that's the key that the shuttle is going to be in effect.
And the first 2 weeks are free of charge.
Yes, right. Mm-hmm. Free. As Kevin said, it'll be leaving from the VF outlets behind Willoughby's. It's going to use Park Road and Penn Avenue. It's going to make a loop through the downtown. stopping. City Hall, County Courthouse area, another stop on Cherry Street at the BART, near the BART Transportation Center, and then back across the bridge.
And it's leaving in 15-minute intervals from Wyomissing and from downtown, and it's a
right,
shuttle.
It's every 15 minutes,
right.
But it's only operating during the morning
and
p.m. peak, from 7 a.m. to 10 a.m., and then from 3 p.m. through 6 p.m. After the first 2 weeks, there will be a fare that's associated with it. It's $1.70 per trip. However, you can get a park or a bar to pass for $31 a month, and that includes the parking over at VF.
We're trying to encourage downtown folks to utilize this, whether you work at the Courthouse Services Center, City Hall, Santander Bank, those are probably, and Reading Area Community College, the big employers, but also we encourage people that get called in for jury duty. There are Mondays that there are several hundred people that are called downtown. They're not accustomed to the traffic flow in downtown. Ready may not have been downtown for a couple of years. We're encouraging them. It's going to be sent out to prospective jurors with their information that says, look, if you're called for jury duty, the best thing for you is to probably consider parking your car behind R.J. Willoughby's and riding the shuttle to downtown Reading, which is really a great opportunity. We're trying to take the stress off of the day-to-day commuters, because we joke about this. We are in Reading and in that general area 5 days a week. We know our way around. We know the side streets. We know the alternative routes if there's a blockage for an accident or an emergency. So we know our way around. It's the folks who come in intermittently
right.
that we really think are going to have the most impact. And, of course, visitors to downtown Reading and to West Reading and Wyomissing. We want them to tune in to their GPS. We did have some interaction with some of the GPS folks that provide the TomToms and the GPS units to let them know that the bridge is going to be closed and they can find alternative routes on their GPS. So we think we have every base covered. If folks out there think that we're missing something, we're a very open and responsive group. Gail Landis can be found at the Chamber through her email account, and I don't have it off the top of my head. She'll let you know what it is.
It's glandis@greaterreadingchamber.org.
Right. And Kevin Barnhardt, that's K as in Kevin, B-A-R-N-H-E-R-D-T, at countyofberks.com. Any information or any questions or comments you might have, please email Gail or Kevin and let us know. If something we didn't cover tonight you need us to cover for you, we'll get back to you very quickly. What we usually do is ask Alan or Matt Boyer or Ryan Hunter, our county facilities director. We certainly don't have all the answers, but we know where to find them. We know who to go to get those questions answered for you. We want to make sure that people are calm July 20th, and we're kind of glad it is happening in the summer, school being out, people being on vacation. So we're going to kind of ease into the closure. And before we do close, I'd like to have Gail again thank the folks who have been engaged in this for the last 2 years before we sign off.
Yes, and I just want to say everything we've talked about here is updated on readingbridges.net. So if you didn't have a chance to take it all down, go visit readingbridges.net and you'll find the information there. But again, this is not possible without this public-private partnership that we've created and the volunteered resources that everybody's contributing. Be it the county commissioners, be it the Chamber of Commerce, be it the City of Reading, the West Reading Coalition and their foundation, commuter services, BARDA, PennDOT, the entertainment industry,
Visitors
our Convention
Bureau.
And Visitors
right.
Bureau, because we're very much concerned that people come to Reading and come back to Reading again, Greater Reading. So it's a great opportunity for us to come together and make sure we're a vibrant community.
Like I said in the beginning, we're all out of time. Thank you for tuning in to County Connection, sponsored by National Penn Bank. Have a good evening. We'll see you next week.